mic is for the tape. So I'm going to project for everyone in the room, but this is recording for the those who are watching online. So what a great turnout for our first lecture of 2019-20. This is fantastic. So great momentum for the year. Super excited to launch the series. So welcome to the first lecture of the College of Architecture and Design lecture series. And as a college, we're fortunate to have great partnerships and sponsors that allow us to have these types of events. And so tonight, we couldn't have such a great guest with us if it weren't for the Robert B. Church III Lecture Fund. It's a great endowment that allows us to do so much, you know, it's worth thanking that endowment and recognizing that generosity of that endowment every chance that we get. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Jason Young, the director of the School of Architecture, and it's really an honor to introduce tonight's guest speaker, Ricardo deOstos. Ricardo is director of Naja and deOstos, a London-based studio, which has developed in their description as a platform for experimental architectural design. Ricardo's a unit master at both the AA, the Architectural Association, and the Bartlett, two of the most prominent schools of architecture in the world, in my opinion, both historically and certainly in the contemporary moment, and both are located in London. Ricardo has also served as the director of the AA's Madrid Summer School and was a guest professor at the École Spéciale d'Architecture in Paris for 5 years. This teaching that Ricardo does, as well as the work of Naja and deOstos, is pursued collaboratively with his life partner, Nanette Jakowski. In everything that they do, they explore the symbiotic relationship between emerging cultural patterns and architectural narratives. With a strong research-based focus, Ricardo and Nanette seek to generate an adventurous and sometimes dangerous, but always beneficial built environment through critical and challenging speculation. Their work is largely engaged in what they term ambiguous situations within urban and social dynamics for which the studio explores alternative narrative-like scripts. The projects they've done address catastrophic scenarios, contaminated landscapes, corporate fields, and newborn cities. And although the projects are different in scope and scale, all of their work intends to impart a craft to the architecture and also a sense of place.
Thank you. Thanks,
God. So Ricardo and Nanette are also co-author of a number of books. The Hanging Cemetery of Baghdad, published in 2007. Ambiguous Spaces, a Princeton Architectural and Press pamphlet architecture, number 29 in that series, which was published in 28, and the result of an international competition for that honor to publish in that series. And the latest book, which I believe this lecture will trace the contours of, was published in 2017 and is titled Scavengers and Other Creatures in Promised Lands. For 13 years, Naja and deOstos have run the Intermediate 3 unit at the AA, and this latest book features both their professional work and the work of their students from that unit. And I think this is a kind of rare collaboration and a rare attitude towards student work, where they really see their work and the work of their students as sort of coming together and informing one another. And I think that's true for a lot of the teachers here in this school too, but this is an example of a practice that makes little critical distinction between the teaching and the practice. And that I think that's an exciting model for us. So in their words, Inter 3, this AA unit, is well known for producing large atmospheric drawings based on digital as well as traditional methods. More than only illustrations, these drawings are strong compositions that investigate and discuss speculative context as the design of architecture, building, and landscape. The work explores the way architects build up and visualize the image and atmosphere of the world to come. Environmental complexity and social participation are Inter3's main research concerns when exploring infrastructures and social conditions. Through tales of wondrous, unnatural opportunities, unexpected man-machine symbiosis, prototyped visions, and cautionary tales about unforeseen catastrophic scenarios, Inter3 will explore many ways to create architecture space and enrich ambiguous situations. Their words. Now, in my words, I only met Ricardo this morning, and he has a t-shirt on that says, Converge. And I like that t-shirt a lot. I wish I knew what face that was on the t-shirt, but that's okay that I don't know. Some mysteries are okay. But I really like the I really like the theme of Converge. And their work is a convergence. That moment when the imaginary impacts the real world, or the thinking that we have for the future actually conditions the possibility that that future could come true. And the convergence of their trajectory and our trajectories, the convergence of all of our work together, coming together as a college. So I like the theme. I like the t-shirt. I like the theme. And I couldn't be more happy to have Ricardo deOstos kick off this lecture series. Please help me welcome him.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you very much.
You have your mics on.
The mic? Yeah, he's on. Yeah? Okay. Thanks, Jason, for the very nice introduction. I am very, very happy and glad and humbled to be here in front of all of you to bring me up from all the way from London to here to see that beautiful audience and so many people attending. I'm sure that's a constellation that says a lot about the school, because I think schools that can fill lecture halls means that are creating great a culture of great education inside the school. So thanks for having me, Jason. Also, thanks, Mark Stanley, for making the connection and the invitation. Oops. And everyone that I have met today and yesterday, they have been extremely kind to me, showing me around. I appreciate that a lot. And that's the t-shirt. It's probably the most powerful band in the planet right now, so we should just check it. You might not like the music, but the energy of these guys, they are undeniable. They're from your country, so.
I'm an old guy.
Look, I'm getting there. I sit at the back. But Jason was right about the book and the lecture. I wanted to talk about writing the book together with Annette Yakovsky about this strange correlation, which is to be alive in our age and to sort of try to understand that perhaps as the book says, everything that is solid melts in the air. And I think every generation that that reads that phrase and lives that phrase, we have a certain sense of despair and a certain sense of a challenge that things that we learn at school are not really sticking anymore. So I think the idea of writing this book, which is the third book that we've written, is exactly to try to balance and create a harmony between what we teach, what we practice, and start thinking what are the crossroads of our generation, of my generation, what are the crossroads that I thought I was choosing versus the crossroads that I think are suddenly revealing and inverting everything else that is occurring. So there's a lot of things that I would like to talk to you today, and I'll try to have the lecture under an hour. So as I learned from my mentor, bumps don't like to sit more than an hour. So I'll try to clock myself. So the idea of scavengers and other creatures in promised lands started from the conversation that of one of the crossroads being that perhaps the conversation of the environment is not necessarily purely aligned with optimization and percentage, but could the question of the environment, which is a question that I guess everyone cares to some level, could be connected to other factors, meaning culture, meaning ideas and practices which are passed from generation to generation, and what is their validity today. So Scavengers and Other Creatures is basically a book that takes the work of the students of the AA, of our thinking practice, and put it forward the idea of that maybe we can learn from culture to tackle the architectural notion of environment, and then we start unpeeling some of these consequences, and I'll explain today what they are. I want to start with some of the territory that we cover, which is the idea of myth. The myths are not just some nice stories, but they are powerful, subconscious, cross-generational tales that we pass from one generation to another. And this is a biblical story coming from, written by John Milton in Paradise Lost, a classic, a great book, a great poem. If you haven't read, just try to read the first two pages, and it's an incredible narrative, if you like, kind of epic poems. So what you see here is basically the revolt that a beautiful angel had with its master. So that's basically the treachery that Satan and his rebel angels had against God in this classical poem. Is of course derived from biblical narratives, but I'm not talking about religion here. I'm talking about this derived from the poem. So in this story, you have Satan declaring independence from God, and these are angels in heaven. So these rebel angels, they start to fight to have more power, to be more valid, to be more acknowledged. They sound like academics. but we don't fight, right? So suddenly the rebel angels start this big fight, but then there is a whole part of the story that they lose, and these angels together with its leader are casted away in a warm place full of lava and fumes and smells, and they are cursed into that place to stay there forever. This place is what we know as hell, colloquially. But in the poem is an explanation of how this thing comes about. And the interesting part of this initial poem, the initial part of the poem, is that there is a question mark of, after all these angels banned into this place without a name yet, and there is a question of what they should do. So some ex-angels, no, start asking, what are you going to do? What's next? And some of them say, oh, we should, I think it was Beelzebub, ask, like, let's ask forgiveness. Let's go back to heaven and knock at the door. sorry for the cliche, knocking at the door and sort of ask for forgiveness for God, for us to carry on, to join heaven again. Then there is a big discussion, and then Satan, which is literally fallen, he rises and he says this sort of classical phrase that he said, no, we're not going to go to heaven. We're going to inhabit this place, and we're going to give it a name. We're going to build our empire here. He says the phrase, which is, it's better to rule in hell than to serve in heaven. So what is interesting about this narrative is there is a point where these extremely defined eternal beings are lost their identity. They were very clear, the identity with angels, but due to the vanity of Lucifer, which now calls Satan, Satan means the adversary, then suddenly become, there's something in between. And I think that discussion that they have about what do they want to do is exactly the discussion. They become at that point in our understanding something like creatures, something that is undefined, neither angels, neither demons yet. So the term creature comes from the idea that, from the term creare, in Latin means creation, the idea that you are at that point creating something else. You are molding a new transformation, a new identity for you. So this narrative of, which is a classical archetype of the fall, is a good explanation to some transitions and places that we study and visit with our students in our research. Some of the places is Varanasi. This is in India, is where the sacred river Ganges turned north, and is a place where thousands of people converge throughout the year, and especially around November with the light festival. It gets incredibly crowded. People from all over the world, but especially India, converge into that to bath on the sacred waters. And in here, one of the ideas is the river is utilized by many people in different ways. You are seeing a boat. You're seeing people washing clothes. But if you draw a long section across the river in Varanasi, you see people washing clothes north, then a little bit down they are peeing and defecating on the river, and then a little bit down the river they are drinking the water, then a little bit down they are doing sacred rituals. You see someone floating and praying on the water. There's a little bit down the river further you see cremation, so they cremate their bodies along the river and they drop the bodies on the water. You have, and then on the other side, you have this very plain, flooding plain in front of the city, which is extremely dense. This is some of the view from the other side where the city is. So you might ask yourself, well, why are they utilizing the river in that sort of schizophrenic way? You know, don't they know that it's polluted? You might call this misinformation or simply lack of knowledge or ignorance. But the interesting discussing with many people in the city and a few visits we did there is some of these people drinking the water, which is one of the most polluted waters in the world, river waters, is that some of them are the scientists which are in the rest of the day doing research on water purification. So they are the ones who get the sample and do the test and see that is that amount of diphtheria and bacteria is present on the water. And speaking with them, they said that they know that it's polluted, but it's more important for them to partake into what their parents and grandparents partake into that communion with the rituals that they do every day, than to ignore that for the idea of the water. So they know, they do not deny. Some people, other people, tend to say that the sacredness of the river will purify the water, but that's not the case for most people there with education. They know that it's polluted, but they decide to community that we're partaking with that to continue this cross-generational conversation. So there is an interesting correlation there where they make a decision that goes against the sort of the scientific knowledge. They make a decision that goes not in denying that, because they still finding tactics and strategies to purify the water as they, but they made a decision to put forward first the communion with the water, which is something extremely interesting, and actually put forward a narrative that how can we learn from culture, even cultures that we might not understand initially why there is that decision, and how that culture can lead to certain environmental propositions that take into consideration those practices. Even sometimes they are paradoxical. So you might say, what is a city? Where is the place where those mythical and sacred and memorial, mnemonic knowledge exist? So let's try to understand that a little bit more, and Giambattista Vico, an Enlightenment thinker, helped us with that. So he said this was the order of human institutions. First was the forest, then the huts, then the villages, then the cities, and finally the academy. So for his Enlightenment thinking, the academies were the pinnacle of universe of mankind, and the forest was his antagonist, the place of darkness where giants, myths, and the sort of unenlightened person will exist, as a mythical anecdote of the thinking of the time. But it's quite interesting if you look at understanding of what lands are, not the land necessarily of hell, for example, but lands that have mythical power and mythical qualities. So mythical lands are a place charged with memories, where ancestral ties and social and religious practices bind people together. So in Varanasi, there is a choice to inhabit a mythical land for a good part of the day, where those elements are come forward in the narrative in order to make decisions where they would then shift to another types of understanding. So just to create a kind of a more clear understanding, this is for less of what Jura land can be read, which is what we deal with, let's say, practice of architecture in a daily basis, which is land is actually rights. There are legislations that control that. You have rights to do things and other and things that you can't do. In mythical land, you have different types of rights, which is connected to ritual. You validate your existence in that land by those rituals, those practices, those communions. In the other, you have law that give you those rights, that you can legislate. And the other one, you have myth. Myth is what tends to, in some level, bind people to their land, that creates a contract that can illuminate how people will behave in certain situations. Talking about mythical land. And here, the property is transferable. That means that we can sell the land, you know, for perhaps the best, the better, for a better price. And here, you kind of don't sell your land for money. I guess we all have that conundrum when someone, for example, the grandparents' house or farm, when they pass away, in my case, for example, no one wants to sell the land because there is a emotional tie with that place, and no one wants to get rid of that. Even is extremely difficult to take care for urban folks. So ancestral bonds creates emotional ties with places. It's not about price, it's about what connects you to that land. In rural lands, you have boundaries. In mythical lands, you have centers. You have boundaries, you know, a property has boundaries. And in here, you have centers. You have centers of power, you have centers of worship, centers of congregation. And here, Jura land resource, the land, for example, in where we're going to see many examples, you can exploit. You can take materials, trees, and other primary resources. And here you have a different generational affinity with constructing, with tying together, with sewing carefully together through generation those stories. So more or less, the mythical land looks like that. If you know the Ouroboros, which is the snake eating its own tail, that kind of well-known symbol. And here, we just to illustrate what we're saying, we just took the Ouroboros, which talks about eating its opposite and recycling its opposite back into the cycle of beginnings. We just actually took the diagram from the forest transforming to the city, that transformed back into the forest. And that this is the cosmology of the mythical land, a place where there is a cycle. The myths, to some level of understanding, the myth was based on harvest cycles, moon cycles. So that means that to every hard work after harvesting something, there was a celebration. So people went over, celebrate, creating masks, dance, songs, ways to construct, ways to disassemble things. So, but this is cyclical. This is what you don't have the cycle of progress here. You have the everlasting return of that cycle every year. So there's a certain predictability sort of and return to that cycle, because it tends to be seasonal or connected to cycles of the of known patterns. Example, but what happens when these two meet, the Juro and the mythical? This is a Nigurara canvas from Australia, which talks a bit about this confrontation of the two when they meet. So in here you have, this is a painting produced, a 10 by 12 painting produced by the Aboriginals in Australia. And basically they lost the right to their land. They couldn't, they lost the property, the land as property. So they had to leave, and they said, look, but this is important to us because here is our practices. People change from child, from adolescent, the rites of passage happen in this land. But for the law, they said, but there's nothing here. We didn't build a single hut. There's nothing traceable here. So they produced, after the failed attempt to produce one drawing to illustrate that empty space is full of existing visible structures, they produced this canvas with several Aboriginal artists that talk the idea that all these water wells, they are actually part of a path that takes them into a summer journey to the sacred tree where they sleep, and then they have the dream for their identity. And these other paths and the trees are also connected to stops, water wells, sacred rocks. So the understanding of the land is also the cosmology that validate what they are as a group. In this case, it's not democracy. In this case, it's actually the myths and the rites that bind them together. So the idea here that they use the story to validate their existence, to validate and to tell those stories for a judge, is a way that they managed to actually get their land back. So in 1992, I think it was 1992, they showed this canvas in the courtroom, and they managed to get their land back because they showed that those invisible structures, they are invisible, but they exist. So that mythical land is mythical and is real. It's not a contradiction. And inhabiting that space and learning from these places and learning from places where I grew up as well, we take some of these. These are some drawings from the book that we produce. And this is trying to portray Varanasi and explain the story of Varanasi and that polluted river and how the city is changing. So what we're very interested in is not to take mythical land and elevate for an aspect of the only truth, but we're interested to see, like in the canvas, what is the friction that occurs between that legacy and the digital structures, the industrial legacies, and the infrastructural pressures that are happening in cities today. So making drawings is a way also to put into paper thoughts and ideas that otherwise will not be understood. So in this drawing, we're describing, utilizing several perspectives, the River Ganges in plan, the very dense east side, with the floodplains on the west, the offerings that also pollute the river but are essential for the city, these invisible arms, which are Shiva lingas every day that are being offered in Varanasi, and they are invisible, but here we just manifest them physical. And at the same time, the nuclear, the self, the family cell, which is constantly shifting from, which is starting to shift from being more traditional to being more contemporary through people owning iPads, being a lot more digital literate, and a generation that is looking at the city as a future smart city. So we learn from that, those sensibilities, and rather than to promote either or, we're interested about understanding that sense of possibilities lost and how we can portray, how can we draw those possibilities? How can we understand that somehow invisible structures are also to be understood, and perhaps they are the key point for many communities? So this is, for example, a second year student, Charlotte. She was investigating the difference between the one drop that falls through this sacred structure and the introduction of water pumps in that region. This is a student project that tries to investigate that a part of the structure is actually cleaning the river through algae, but at the same time, rather than to be infrastructure only, is also a place where boatmen come to clean their boat, and that the dirt from the boat that gets under the boat is utilized also in the filtration process. When the river floods to a certain level, this becomes a workshop, because they don't work during the maximum flood part of the Ganges River. So trying to find ways to get these two to have a conversation, not to deny the existence of one as ignorant, but also not to hail the other as the only way of doing architecture, meaning purifying water. This is also a second year drawing, I think this was an A0, that is talking about this pneumatic structure where to clean a portion of the river, a little arm of the river that goes downstream, she ties up to a ritual that occurs in that area. So this pneumatic structure is also purifying the water. That's the water that they use for this ritual. But also it teaches them through social practices and cultural practices that you can tie two together. The idea of technology, the idea that these rites can be a way to promote a change in the city, but also understand and validate that their culture is also important for them. It's so important that they bypass scientific knowledge sometimes in order to commune with that. So also the idea of imagination, how sometimes the students can take the ideas and ask for a what if. What if we could take parts of water of one area and take to another area? What happens if these are connected to rituals and also become sort of celebrations of the culture? Some of that translates in our own work. This is a work that we did at Nine Deostos, the studio, as Jason said, I have with Annette Yakovsky. Where in this area there is a high level of evaporation, so we use this sort of water roofs for this transport interchange, separating more the machine area from the kind of human inhabitation area, and sort of creating this sort of vast water vessel on the roof that will work with the rainwater, capturing this water and dripping this water through the columns of the building, working with the cycle of the rain. Continuing the idea of water and the spaces and potential architectures, this is the capital of the state of Amazonas in Brazil, Manaus. It's an extremely interesting place. It's very seasonal. I'll explain more about the forest later, but this is the Rio Negro. This area floods, and this area, unfortunately, sometimes throughout the year it gets packed with rubbish. In English you say PET bottles, it's kind of 2-liter Coke bottles. Do they have a name? Plastic bottle, yeah. Yeah, so these plastic bottles, they clog this river. Now there's not, you can't see much, but during the flood, all the rubbish comes into this place they call Igarapés. And there is really hard to promote the way or how people can throw rubbish more consciously. And going up river, you see that a lot of these Igarapés, they seasonal. So they gotta pass into these areas, which are these water arms, no, the go from the main river sideways. They are seasonal cities, basically. They go from people in the past, they used to go into these areas for inhabitation, so they work for 3-4 months, get the money, buy boots, food, and go into the, when the river, the water was up, they get their boat and their family into those areas. You stay there when the water is getting to the minimum possible for them to navigate. They go back to the city. And these are areas unreachable with enough speed to do without water. That's why there is extremely hard to build any roads in the Amazon, because it gets destroyed by the furious rain and temperatures of that region. But anyway, they got a pass there. They offer a possibility of a different way of reading what inhabitation is in a city. Going along the river, you see a lot of these structures of infrastructure. This is a ruin from a rubber boom that happened in the early 20th century, now abandoned. So you start understanding that the city of Manaus, in the capital of the forest, is only there because there was this trade, the trade of wood, resources. So in this sense, the Amazon was seen a lot as a land rights, as property, as resource. And the architecture that occurs on the outposts in the region, they were mainly for extraction. Once it wasn't profitable anymore, they, in a matter of months, they got abandoned, the managers left. And this is one of the ruins eight hours up the Rio Negro. So we're very interested to try to understand the idea of land as dual and land as mythical, and try to understand what are the sensibilities that we can learn from culture, that we can learn from the way of telling stories, communicating to one another in order to create past information, but also create understanding of what environmental possibilities can be, and at the same time seeing how can certain ways of thinking which are encrypted in some traditions can actually help us to tell stories and understand where we are. Because what is interesting about many pre-industrial traditions is that they had no problem with the invisible world. No, they had no problem to talk about interrelational things, utilizing the language, which is highly symbolic, no, which is, as Bernard Stiegler said in his book, A Symbolic Misery, is very hard for us to acknowledge that symbolism. But for these tribes in the border between Peru and Brazil, they had no problem of making a maquette of their house, and the guy was big time, almost like fitting inside the house. He was huge, no? This is not a mistake. This is not a... And another person is actually hanging on the roof. So we take for granted that these are the ways that people did, but I think there is... Here they took, in this archaeological study, show that in this particular area, these are water vessels or wind pipes, and they use this to take every day. So when you go home, instead to take your keychain or your mobile, you take a maquette of your house. And you go with you, you take it's your bottle, and it's also a way to tell the story of who you are. So a lot of this sort of a chromatic clashes, and I wouldn't call kit bashing because that's something absolutely different, but these combinations of scale in order to tell stories and accentuate these stories in objects is something that we are very keen to understand and so also learn. How this, in this case, is a wind mechanism, how those stories can be serve as a way to to incorporate those stories perhaps in a more drastic way to communicate them. We learned from some of these narratives, in terms of sensibilities and draws, with the notion that culture is dynamic, which I think nowadays is something quite absurd to say, as we tend to sort of sometimes jump in the defense of culture or stagnation. But what is interesting to study is that culture is dynamic. It changes. It learns from one another, especially also in the Amazon area, where through the interchange and of the igarapés, the tribes used to exchange it a lot throughout the rainy season. So there's a lot of studies that actually show that this exchange wasn't documented so well because people always saw the Amazon during the dry season to some level, never understood that these exchanges were actually made before during the or seasonally through this summer rain periods. So in this way, students try to take some drawings just like this, these drawings are not proposition, they are meditation, they are ways to try to understand what's happened on the context. This one is also a student that was understanding, this is one of the ruins of the Amazon, which was taken by fire ants. So the student was making a drawing trying to communicate how the underworld actually defined the narrative of the upper world. And there are several myths on the Amazon that talks how fire ants run down this place, but that's not true. That's actually due to the erosion of the commerce of rubber. So drawings here become a way, something before the proposition, something that you can think by making a drawing. This other drawing by Alvaro Pupeiro, which now is a Spanish guy, which is now is a filmmaker in Colombia, and is making his second feature film about the Civil War in Venezuela. And he did this project on his third year with us and was talking exactly about how the Amazon can be translated and communicated one pixel at a time, celebrating the Amazon in this gel capsules, not as a HD definition by National Geographic where you zoom in a blue frog and everything looks great. He wanted to tell a story of a very low res Amazon, which you dissect and absorb one pixel at a time. Or Eleonora, which it positions her building / infrastructure / celebration / waste recycling in the Igarapé where the picture was taken, and the red is made out of melted plastic, which are the wings of this kind of parrot-like, which also controls the wind and also creates this creature out of the recycling of this ever-growing creature at the border of the city where they can see how this rubbish is piling up and creating this creature. So it is at the same time telling a narrative, cataloging, quantifying, creating a different chromatic reading on the river, aesthetical, and playing a role of infrastructure. So I think from this phase, we're trying to find ways to draw, ways to hybridize infrastructures, which tends to be seen as large dams, large performative space, which are a very important place to operate the cities that we live. But we're doing this sort of minuscule work in order to try to see what's possible to think, if we can think together of infrastructures that can learn from human scale or cultural practice. So students find their own ways of, these are drawings by the students, Sharon and Shashi, working between scales, working between ways to perceive the environment. And it's quite interesting, you might say, but these things are highly speculative, Ricardo. They really don't come into the world. And they seem to have more of a well-defined academic place, which I think is partially true. But I've been proved wrong over and over again by looking at some of my heroes, which are Gabriel Garcia Marquez and Salman Rushdie. And these two had interesting confrontations with reality. They are, anyone knows them? Yeah. This is Gabriel Garcia Marquez, who wrote 100 Years of Solitude, the Colombian writer, which became this, let's say the word, style called magical realism, which I'm very inspired by because it shows how the magical, which is seen as the invisible, right, and the real can overlap in a very matter-of-fact way. This other Salman Rushdie, he wrote The Satanic Verse, and let's see how both of them met reality. This was a trip I did in Colombia, and to my total shock, when I was in the airplane, this was the slogan of the tourist department of the whole country, which is started with a book that he wrote in his holiday with his family in the coast in Colombia, and now has been co-opted and instrumentalize it into the sort of the touristic touristic strategy for the whole country in a very sort of a predatorial way. So it meets reality becoming mainstream and actually becoming kind of encompassing a set of other practices that are used for different purposes as well. And unfortunately, Rushdie didn't have such a good outcome out of his book. He was seen as a blasphemy, and Ayatollah from Iran put a fatwa on him, which that means that for people to kill him. So he was he was protected by the MI5, I think from the late 90s until the late 80s until early 90s, he was into hiding with his family. So his books were burned. This is UK, by the way. His books were burned. He was had death threats. And this is, both books are magical realism. Both books were saying things about culture, were getting culture out of the comfort zone, and were putting culture in confrontation with other tales, with other variant narratives. So sometimes to talk about fiction, to talk about imaginative things, it also meets reality, zips into the mainframe. And in fact, it seems that what we call reality is constantly looking for a more elastic, panoramic view of what that reality can be. And these cultures are even more absorbed nowadays through digital social network platforms. This project, The Pregnant Island, talks about, this is exhibit outside. It talks about some of these narratives of magical realism. Is a building, if you can call that, in the Amazon, where they build a huge dam and the water goes up and down by, I think, 16, 17 meters. It's a very aggressive environment. And so the tribes had to exit this place. They being removed. And 1,600 top of hills became 1,600 islands, where species got trapped on the top of these hills, which are now islands. So there was a whole, when we visited the area, there was a whole new ecosystem. There were islands just with one species of monkey dominating, and other islands with one species of snakes or fire ants. So it was a very interesting and strange place. But so we did this project not for the people. We did this project as a way to catalog and think about the ways that people used to live in that region, because they are not documented by oral history. So there is very little documentation. So the project tackles about the understanding of nature, which for them, nature is not a parochial view. They don't say Mother Nature. For them, nature is alive. Is a threat, is not a friend. So it's less of Mother Earth for them, and it's more, they have a relationship, a very complicated relationship, that they know if they hunt too much, the predators will come and probably eat their children at night. So they have a view of environmental balance through myth. So they tell their tales they should not hunt that bird during that season because that bird is connected to the predator. So in this absurd magical realist story that we created, we wanted to design their building and reconfigure their social structure, sorry, their architectural structure of cultural practice that happens horizontally, but because the water goes up and down, it's placed vertically. The Maloca building doesn't have a meeting space anymore because you can't in the central area. The buildings are, they use seed, rubber, and bamboo. And as this was one of the places that discovered rubber as insulation material. Also, the red of this creature-like building is also using, forgot the name, urucum, which is this red powder that you crack and then you use in your skin. And that's jenipapo, which is this black cream that you get out of fruit. And the building reacts to this actual literal pregnant island. So the island is pregnant and is swelling. It has mood variations. And people are constantly at the hands of this terrible island, which is probably about to give birth and no one knows. And this building is there, relating to that and also relating to this variation of the water. So the story of this project is a story that tries to compress in a, I can say, inspired by magical realism, the confrontation of these two factors, the imaginative, which is very real, which is embedded, encrypted into myths that become social practice, and also the historical generational element, which is rubber, seeds, bamboo, that is now is lost in the region. So there is a sort of generational impoverishment because it's not, the practice is not alive. I'll probably have to speed up a little bit. This is another project which is also exhibit there, is the Hanging Cemetery. This is the first project we ever did. So this project, I was actually working at Foster and Partners during the day, and I was going to protest on the streets with Nanette and our colleagues. But there was a question that my mentor had said during my years at school. He said, architecture can do more. I was always puzzled by that, and do more what? I mean, there's people, so many people are creative already at the Bartlett, and then I thought, oh, maybe I can try, we can try to discuss what's happening with a project. And I think here, as the first project, I become an expert on subjects which are not of my business. And I'm not from Iraq, I've never been, and the project is not about the people in Iraq, but the project is about how we perceive that geography through TV and newspaper in a daily basis. So the project started by the emergence of a statistics that the 24,930 casualties had occurred in the first year of the invasion in Iraq, instead of 100,000 casualties that have been put forward by the Iraqi war, by the alliance. So the idea was to really, rather than to point fingers, just to try to tell that story about this number, you know, how we perceive that number and how that structure of death is present constantly on the city of Baghdad. So the project is not about the actual city, it's a city that exists through media. So the project called the Hanging Cemetery of Baghdad, it only exists through 6 CCTV cameras, just like the reality of Baghdad for us. So this is seen through one of the cameras. This structure is very cluttered and not friendly at all. People take hours to go up this ramp. And once they get there, everything's a mess. The mosques are all inverted. The domes are looking down, are inverted. The place of ablution on the mosques are at the end, so to wash is also confusing. This place also became a place where the bodies became, so many casualties occur that that this place becomes more of a factory as well. And to see its end is not possible, it's always a continuous place. So the bodies are processed into this traditional way of this white behemoth where they wrap the bodies in white cloth and they take to the cemetery up here. And you have the cemetery end up becoming this sort of a theater of death with the shadows playing reminding people of the of this place in a daily basis. So it's extremely unfriendly design. It's not a project that is to be liked. And I learned that from when I saw Dostoevsky talking about a Cervantes Don Quixote book. He was saying, like, how can you create something? Why did Cervantes create a character and beat that character so much? No, he was confused about how he created Don Quixote and treated that beloved character so badly throughout 400 pages until a point that he actually thinks that he doesn't exist, that he's actually part of a book. He was right. So it was quite interesting kind of opening that light into the possibility that instead to try to defend the project and the pursuit of that project as the best possible result was the idea that we really wanted to tell the story and encapsulate a narrative that exists through space creation, which is the language that we practice. So this was never built, was not intended to be built as a commentary project, part as well of this sequence of projects. Anyone knows Neil Gaiman? Yeah? For this one, I'll ask hands up. Who knows Neil Gaiman? Okay, cool. Yeah, you guys know American Gods? Okay. So American Gods is by a British writer. He's actually based somewhere in America. I don't know where. So is this now it has become a series on Amazon, the Amazon Prime, they call American Gods. And I think it helps also to do a recap on what we've been talking about in the lecture so far. Because American Gods take this kind of Neil Gaiman storytelling that he did on The Sandman. If you like 1% of what I'm saying here, or 1% of graphic novels, you must read The Sandman. It's a series of graphic novels, which is an incredible, I wouldn't say entertaining, but it's a beautiful storytelling in a different medium. So in American Gods, he does something interesting. He's talking about there's a war, and this, and there is a war between the old gods and the new god. So on the American Gods, the old gods start getting together, and the American gods are very kind of, these gods, they came with the immigrants. So when the immigrants came across the sea, across the land, they didn't come alone. They came also, they brought together these invisible structures, no? These places, these beliefs, these practices. And even though they're a bit diluted, they're a bit perhaps not so formed, they're still alive. So we celebrate them through festivities, you know, annual festivities, or the way that people dress a cap. So in here is this war that this guy, which is Odin, which is this and that shadow. So they go into this kind of a classical American narrative of crossing the country, and then he goes enlisting the gods, and the gods are, you know, drug addicts. They are the sort of a different contemporary characters, and then he goes enlisting them into this fight for this new god that is technology. So the book really sets up an interesting story about that idea that the actual things that they are part of a tradition, they never really die away. They transfigure, they transform, they change course. And I think here he sets up a confrontation between the two. But I'm very interested to see how these two come together, which they already come together through social network, and also how we see ourselves in our own bubbles. So this is practices which are centuries old, that people move their houses. But now they move their houses because the river tide is changing. So annually, they get their houses on wheels, on bike wheels. Traditionally, they used to do that. when people move there from a place, in Indonesia, they used to take their house with them. So literally those myths, those structures, the house is actually a living character for them, traditionally. So they wouldn't abandon that structure. No, they take the structure with them. Which again is an interesting lesson on our conversation with American gods, the idea that the acknowledgement of those structures, which is embedded, encrypted on the architecture, here becomes also transportable and visible. Now that has been normalized to some extent, for example, in these simple ways that the houses to move in Cambodia and Indonesia are part of a tradition in seasonal areas, especially where the river tide is changing. Going to one project, this is one of the rivers, one lake that has been flooded with sand. This is in the capital of in Phnom Penh in Cambodia. So this Bangkok Lake, it used to be a lake where fishermen used to plant vegetables and also was the main natural drainage system of the city. But now they put a water pipe here. They filled this lake, one of these three lakes. This is the main one. So it's a huge lake. So they removed the fishermen. They drove them away. And then they made this site for an expensive, luxurious development for a Chinese developer. But this was how they used to live, is an example of a different area in a lake in Cambodia, where the structures were seasonal. And the seasonal, sometimes during the year, you had a street, and another time, that street was filled up to here. So when it floods, they live into this area, and then they maneuver, like in the Amazon, with their boats in these villages. And when the water goes down once a year, this becomes workshops, streets, trades, visitors, motorbikes. This doesn't exist the whole year. So there's this pressing element. There is, wow, it's interesting. Someone is thinking about seasonal cities here. It's not a city that is 24/7 serving us all the time, which is a lesson that we learn from the Amazon as well, that there is a possibility of thinking seasonal spaces in different scales. But some of them are being evaporated by certain developments. So Maya, one third-year student, took that site, which is right here with the dotted line, and she created an axis to connect this political this political buildings into the river. So she took this axis, and a big fight that occurred on the press, the World Bank gave back to this fisherman 14% of the corner of this area, but there's no lake. No, they were fishermen. I mean, what are they going to do on that site? So Maya had a very rude idea to give even less, to give them 3% instead of 14%, with the idea that she will create a context reading. Oops. A context reading, a rereading of this context of villages, seasonal villages into the site, reappropriating some of those cultural practices into the building. So what she does is that she creates this vegetable plantation vertically and create these bamboo structures, stretching the lower part of these houses to extreme, to now compare and match the existing new site, which is vertical towers. And what she created is that, which is a version of those houses, flooding houses, but now the ground level is stretched up. Now that line that connects the two parts of the city connects the political power of the city to the river. This also creates a market. It creates a market through this area where they sell and buy vegetables and plant vegetables. She recreates a part of the lake within a stripe just under this where they can use the water and look after the water. And she creates also a new thing that didn't exist in that particular community, but reappropriating that for the urban context, she created these inflatable pillows, and they operate with the hot air. So basically when it's hot, the air expands, and they go up, creating kind of borders in between where the air flows and ventilate the top level where people live. And during the monsoon season, when it rains and the water is colder, these pillows compress and get tied together, so avoiding the rain to fall into these upper areas. So they are not, it's not a floating structure, it's just an environmental way to control that attached to the social practices, but now somehow, if I might say the word, exaggerated to match the new reality. You know, they are updated, they are, if I use a fancy word, they are dislocated using some kind of chromatic mechanism, like in music, you put a chromatic note and gets, like in jazz, you have to pursue that note. Here she utilized non-existing elements like the pillows, which is sort of this chromatic elements, and match the composition with the rest of existing cultural practice through the agriculture and through the elements and through the axis, the street, and creates the project. And then she imagines a what if, or what will be the habitation in these areas. So a lot of the work with the students, they do the first 2 months learning how to think with drawing. So many times the students join the unit, and the first thing we ask them to do is actually to draw freely based on one idea. So we introduce them to one idea. They normally at this stage, they draw by hand. And the main concept there is just to start loosening up and finding ways of how you can explore, first understand you as a designer, because this, all of these drawings are made by second and third years. Understanding the difference between a good idea and a valid idea to a certain context. So iterating with the students and then learning the skills, which are, the skills are not just technical skills, are also thinking skills. And a lot of these projects, by the writing of the book, which is this one, which is Scavengers and Other Creatures in Promised Lands, I'll leave, I told Jason, a few copies to the library. So I guess Jason will let you know when he's at the library. So the idea of was something interesting by insisting on those elements and learning from them, the idea that this speculation and fiction is not somehow a denier of reality as we tend to think and antagonize it, but it tends to be more of a multiplier. It sort of multiply the possibilities. You look at the ground forward and you see, well, actually these are some possibilities that we can also do. So none of these projects are definitive answers of what all of us should do as architects, but are ways to sort of to understand the field of possibilities, and within that field of possibility then see what are the design actions and responses. So out of that, there is something that most of the time when we think about somehow, let me say, social problems, we tend to think, I call it, in a symmetrical way. So for example, we've been to many places where people didn't have houses, no? And if, as architects, guess what we're gonna do if someone doesn't have a house and we are students, no? The response is, we're gonna make houses. We're gonna give that symmetrical response to that obvious problem. But you had a relationship in your life, or you have one, and you know, things are not that straightforward, no? In that relationship that we also have with the problem and people, I call some of these responses kind of asymmetrical response for an obvious problem. So we try to avoid the jumping on the obvious answer, which is let's do housing, or for example, and try to understand what is at the stake, where this problem originate, where is it going. And sometimes to do that, it doesn't start by making a plan. We don't start necessarily by doing a section. It starts with a design response. Sometimes we do some drawings which are meditational, you know, which is like, let me try to understand the problem, the nature of the problem. And those meditational drawings, they help you with to put spell out possibilities that otherwise will not be allowed into the project if you take a solution too early. So at the beginning of the course, I think a lot of the students, they go with the flow, but somehow it takes some time for them to get to own those ideas and to feel that those ideas are not just capricious possibilities that we play inside the school, but it's actually a way to organize knowledge, that they are part of that knowledge. They are choosing how to organize that knowledge and at the same time give responses which might cross a scale. They might go from infrastructure, they might talk about infrastructure, perhaps not address it. They might talk about inhabitation, they might talk about symbolism, but it's not trying to solve all these problems. So maybe I'm going to be highly unpopular, but I have to say, one of the parts of this of the thinking as well is that perhaps the idea, none of these projects, they are utopian or dystopian. They are not looking for a perfect world, devising one. They're not looking also to create perhaps a reflective, contemplative, contemplative way to look at as when the problem goes bad, and then we visualize that. I think they are trying to create possibilities of how this meeting between the new and the old come together, and what are different possibilities that we have to create responses. This is a project in Sri Lanka also that works as a habitation that is this structure is in front of the city on the sea, and it's being built in demand in relation to what happens in the city with the lack of, with the real estate development. So students also, they operate challenging questions that nature should be isolated, and they try to find ways of how humans can occupy some spaces in order to relate to them and create ways to inhabit those spaces. This is a place which at the moment is being eaten by the borders, and the student was asking the question, what happens if we simply create ways to inhabit that kind of ecosystem in order to maintain it? Other students are looking at the possibility of a time frame, looking at how a 400-year building will grow, taking the tradition of a place that they rebuild these temples every year in the circle of fire due to earthquakes in the region. So the student here, Ling Lang, was understanding guided growth, how trees grow, manipulate their growth, and also understanding why does he exist somewhere in the world, practices that they constantly demolish and rebuild the temples every year, because it's also an act of remembering, you know, is an act, by making is also an act of remembering and partaking into those elements. So again, when we talk about rituals and mythical land, doesn't mean that we're talking exclusively about highly religious areas. We're talking about cultural practices that can also create social connections, that do create social connections. And most of these places that we visit, we take them for granted that they are places of infrastructure. Forests are places where you don't have technology, but this is one of the most technological places I've ever been, and I have the luck to be to Alibaba in China. And this place is, I think, as technological as Alibaba. Alibaba is the sort of Amazon from China. And this is a forest in Borneo, Indonesia. All the trees planted are tagged with a QR code. All of them are digitally traceable. All of them, who cuts the tree, where the tree goes to make what is traceable. They have here, when you move around, you have kind of drones flying, mapping the area constantly. This forest is constant. It took us 16 hours to get here driving. But this forest is completely digitalized. As we tend to, so perhaps the narrative of Giambattista Vico now is upside down. The places of infrastructure are not places of darkness, but actually places where highly digitalized, where this world of the rural and the forest are ahead of the cities in terms of technology. So some of the last part of the lecture now is to talk about some of that meeting between technology and culture. And this is one of the drawings of the exhibition that talks of one of these places. So this is a quarry outside Bangalore. And this is a quarry that is completely quarried out on the other side as well. This is just a thin structure outside, is quarried out, mined out. And this is a little thing here. Let's get closer to see what that is. Is a temple, is a Ganesha temple, is a temple that exists amid a very, this kind of epic infrastructural site where people are dynamiting and mining this every day, and everything is out. People, these are migrant workers who live at the border of the mine. They come here to work for some months, but this is the only building that remains, and is accessed through this very kind of perennial dangerous place to go up here, but he exists for several reasons. No, he exists to maintain a connection between the land and the people, even though he's extremely resource-based site. It's still this kind of peace dot, a dot of mythical land, where these guys, at the end of the day, they go there to make their prayers and to leave their offerings, even in their extreme poverty in this area, in some of this area, not everyone. So there is this remain, this kind of a clash between these two and this site, which is part of this drawing as well, which I explained for some students earlier. And we go to another place, and this place called Makrana in India as well, in a different part of India, which is west, northwest. This place is where the Taj Mahal came from. I don't know if you guys, I guess you know the Taj Mahal. It came from here. Sometimes my pronunciation is different from yours. So this is where the Taj Mahal comes from. And it's an extremely interesting place because it talks about that correlation of, that we talk about the beginning of the lecture, of the transformation of something into something else, into the transmutation of a city into a mine, into the correlation between international market and local inhabitants, and the price of stone. So in this area, you see this big scar, which is the most sci-fi place and the most incredible, scary place I've ever been. They shift, this scar in this place shifts according to the price and the necessity of stone, of I think part of it is marble, into this area to the international market. So according to our trends, you know, what we put in on our toilets and houses across the world, or maybe what's fashionable in the Italian Milan fair, that scar will shift a little bit more to the left. So these guys, please, just get out of there. Or sometimes they go backwards. So this is a trend reader. Is this car is reading the trends that we inhabit in the city, making holes in this place and building volumes in other areas. And guess what we found here? Another temple. Just at the corner, not at the beginning, but everything is mined out. This at the back is still, there's some rocks being used as infrastructural sites, But again, another temple in that place that talks about many things, that talks about the necessity to for them to commune, that talks about also this coexistence of these two in this land, but also talks about the idea of constant transformation of the land, that what they're doing here is being constantly informed or connected to those practices as well that are millennium old. I think that's the last quote before I continue. So Robert Redfield said this incredible thing in his book, the story of the transformation of mythology from its original primitive form, in which the vision is backward, to a form characteristic of crisis and change and of civilization, in which the vision is forward, is an important part of the story of utopias and of planning for reform. So this is incredible. When I read, I was reading this many times. I even know the page numbers, page 129, because I couldn't believe when I read this, and based on the book as well, that he gave us a piece of insight into the idea that the correlation between the myth and the idea of, and disruption of progress, which is putting into motion the idea that the reform is forward, while myth tends to be seen cyclical. No, the snake points backwards, and while the idea of progress is constantly forward. And this kind of transformation of mythology from this primitive form, that the vision is backward here I interpret as this sort of cyclical, the idea that there is a seasonality, that you want to be what your parents used to be. You want to be correlated to that cycle of social structure that you belong, to a place where most of us do not do what our parents did. My grandparent was a cowboy taking cattle from A to B in Brazil in the 20th century. And my parents were the ones who managed to migrate from my mom from the farm when she was 20, into the city, as most people did in Brazil in the sort of late 60s, mid 60s. So there is an interesting way that the diagram shifts now, and the mouth of the snake is not eating its tail anymore. So in this case, all the forest transform into the city, that transform back into the forest is gone, and this world is oozing out of this well-orchestrated, expected world. So what you have here is a place where the narratives that used to be cyclical are now outside of this cycle of rebirth, meaning that a lot of the communities that are being displaced in places that we visit, like in the coast of Bangladesh, they don't have a cycle of rituals and festivities, and after the fishing, they have the continuity of their life cycle into their family, but they're now being displaced to the capital, Dhaka. And somehow, when they get to those places, they look at what are the narratives available. The narratives to go back to that partake does not exist because they've been out of that place. So many of them are being radicalized into believing in extremist narratives, extremist stories about promised lands that tends to point destructively backwards. Ideas of land which tends to look more a vengeful return to a glorious past, as if our past is always greater than the future ahead. So what this diagram is start telling, that the world which was compacted, which I'm just doing a statement, I'm not saying it's good or bad, that was compacted inside the myth diagram, now is oozed out and it's lost its connection to the land itself, meaning that to the framework that validates the day-to-day practice. We see that a lot in disaster films, no? To some more immediate level, when something happens, no one knows what to do. So they try to get together and react to that fall, not to the archetype of the fall And then who do you want to be? Do you knock at the heaven's door? Or we actually try to desperately clinch to other narratives which are being sold to us. So they talks about this sort of disruption. And the scavengers is a theme that occurs in many places, and we've seen this in many books, in films like and books like The Road by Cormac McCartney, and which is a film as well. The scavenger is this person that goes into the land that is lost, and they try to scavenge, pick places, find a livelihood, which is made out of pieces. A scavenger in the book is talking about a creature condition that is talking about once you lose something, how do you rebuild? How do you reconnect the parts between that is traditional and also that is unavoidable, which is technology? So it's talking about this perhaps very American gods, this, but instead of a fight of how they can, in a design proposition perhaps, meet. So in this kind of ideas, students test, students react to things by reconstructing, and we as our projects as well design installations that try to understand the role of technology as a role of also understanding how these traditions are or habits are passing forward. This case is an ectoplasmatic library we're building in Paris. So these two creatures here which open up these water containers are they read the use of the space and the space and it freeze this water and the space is constantly measuring and changing with these 4 weeks that this installation is staying in this gallery in Paris. So here we're trying to say, to understand computational power, you know, which is part of this narrative, not inside a laptop, inside a mouse, being with a keyboard, but we're trying to understand computational power as part of a space where maybe the space is reading is a way that we navigate the computational power rather than a laptop with a mouse and a keyboard. So the installation work that we do is very much organizing these narratives and telling the narratives that I've been telling you, but actually asking people to experience that outside the drawing. And this one was in São Paulo with augmented reality. I'm not going to explain much about it, but basically it's similar to the previous one. People saw through the screen this structure growing, which is also a garden, and understood the correlation they have with this infrastructure. When they move, the structure changes and dies and flourish again. So trying to create that kind of macro narrative of Makrana into the sort of micro experiences of these installations. Like the drawings, perhaps trying to get closer to how we can we relate to those conditions. This is a little bit different. This was, again, long story short, is an installation we did in London for the Embassy of Brazil. And similar to the magical realism in Colombia, about cliches. And we've been asked to do something very Brazilian. And they gave me 5 points. And it was an incredible moment for me as a Brazilian and living person. They said that the 5 points that you must work on your design because we spend on our Brazilian branding is nature, beach, football, curves, and something else. I was like, of course. So came back home and we work on something with collaboration with our media artists in London, exploring how the space could be orchestrated. These are exhibitor space. So organizing 100 layers of cardboard into these spaces were for startups and techs. So we wanted to tell the story. There's a projection on the top which is constantly showing the city transforming to forest, transforming to wasteland, and transforms back into forest. And this was in according to how people move through the space. So from here, there's a mezzanine up here, and they could see the flow of people and how they stay in changing the projection, the projection mapping on the top. So with the installation work, we try to create the sort of atomized version of these drawings, but create kind of experiences of this transformation of forest culture and how this variation occurs with technology. Really going towards the end. Here are some other drawings where students try to react, bringing the lyrical into the fold, looking at technology as the sort of a companion of this element of loss that occurs through communities, and creating buildings which harvest updraft wind. They also operate as a lyrical mechanism that it plays itself like an instrument up due to the wind that goes from an updraft, and connecting to temples and other spaces that will bring the community to use that space into these areas. So these projects are also challenging projects because this was made by a third year student. It was probably the second time she ever did a section in her life. So apart from the subject, no, there is the learning about when you cut through something, what do you see? And I guess many of you are passing through that. It's not easy, no, I think tutors somehow think that you guys have a crystal ball. But I think part of this project, there is also really the learning of the skills of an architect, which is to think about space, to think how to communicate what is obvious and visible and invisible about space, and learn how to draw. So this student was making instruments, making kind of piano-like pieces that will operate and hit the strings and get some sonorities and sounds out of them. So she built many models, and she ended up getting the Riba Bronze Medal back in the day for this project. And it was very technical as well, in the sense that she worked very hard to make this happen. She tried to lit an LED with wind. It took her a month to do that. It was painful. Every tutorial she used to come and say, it's not working. Maybe we should move on. Say, no, let's try a little harder until the LED actually did this. And that was an incredible victory and an incredible moment, because I think that gave her the confidence that it took her 3 days, the first 3 days of the year, to build five versions of that wind belt prototype, which led to this project. So I think there is also this sort of the story of the learning that we're very happy that the students, through their enthusiasm and hard work, they help us to frame those strategies. And we're always very open with them that we don't know the end of these projects. It's not that I know where these projects are going. I know why we started those projects. And many times I don't know about the know-how, for example, wind engineer or a media artist, designer. And it was quite liberating a few years ago when I realized that it was okay if I, as a tutor, do not know everything. So I could actually ask, when I say I don't know, which took me when first 2 years I was like, I need to go to the toilet. And later I realized that it's okay if I don't know, because that means that we can find out someone else to come to the studio and talk to people. So it was quite liberating, and I think the studio grew a lot out of bringing strategic guests to bring that know-how. And that sometimes I brought guests from our practice that were working with us. Sometimes the students brought people that end up working with us in our practice. So the last project of the day is by Nathan Su, which was teaching with us last year. And we lost him this year for America. He's going to California to teach. He's actually nothing short to say, but he's simply a brilliant guy. He was doing this project in Sri Lanka and was leading, understanding this idea of technology and local sensibilities. And this is how Sri Lanka was being sold, through glossy renders, the same renders in the lake in Cambodia, promising a promised land of towers, Formula One tracks, Dolce & Gabbana shops, the same animation that you see all over that area in Southeast Asia. This is actually a pot of money that goes around in that area, buying and selling sites into the real estate marketing. So he compiled these renders, these promised lands that are being sold in Bangladesh, in Sri Lanka, and constructed a narrative where what happens if people could have a say before the building ends? If people can have a say, if they can commune with that this invisible world that we have a hard time to understand. We architects like to see physical things and ready things and details, which are super important. But he wanted to think about before the building is built, could people from Sri Lanka have a say about if they like these things or not, if how these things will manifest into their neighborhood? So he created augmented reality city, which is basically seen through small totems and binoculars spread across the region, across the neighborhood, Slave Island in Colombo, in Sri Lanka, and created this system where people could see the buildings that are being proposed. So these are the buildings proposed in the neighborhood, and they constantly are, if they are solid, it means that people want those buildings. They want that building to happen. If there is a little bit of a disbelief and they vote with their phone with likes and dislikes and things, they fragment into these clouds. So these are seen through augmented reality layer through your phone or through binoculars. And interesting that Nathan also understand that for that you need the whole profession, which he called future surveyor. These are surveyors that work with drones and mapping the city, trying to understand what people want and don't want. And surveyors work in these towers, and the drones and the augmented reality are constantly measuring the likability of these buildings to occur. When they blew, that means that the building is completely fragmented, turned blue. That means that the building is not going forward. So it becomes a way to use technology and to avoid certain displacements or projects that will bring more harm than good. But the project was also a way to discuss and to analyze how social network can be part of the city decision making, with the knowledge that it can also be highly problematic also. So the project discussed the meeting of these two, of these invisible layers in the city, discusses the idea of the visualization of that and how this can take shape. And other students as well discuss the ideas of augmented reality, visualization, as a way to tell stories. So stories come out of the paper, sometimes they end up in buildings, but sometimes the students are also seeing how this augmented reality narratives, they are part of kind of mixing characters that are present in the city. Many of these models, many of these drawings that use different scales also end up in models. So this is a roof that collects water, taking the idea of classical roofs in Southeast Asia that collect water to the ground. So these are kind of like bladder-like structures that they collect, and in the kampoons, they utilize this water not just as a water container, but it creates recreational in these areas. This water drips into the life and to the households. And this model was actually a working prototype where Eric was a third-year student, was putting forward his thesis how this water collection could create a upriver in this town and drop off to create these other leisure areas where the water tank, instead to be an infrastructure, now becomes a place of being habit, which is part of the thesis that has been kind of permeating today's conversation as well. What happens when these two meet, you know, the efficiency and the magical and the experiential. So students work with those different layers where a river, a bridge, a path, a library are part of the scenographic study that he made, in this case, run. Students also create different models that convey these different scales. You talk here in the islands macro scale, it goes back to your architecture scale and then you zoom in into the scale of the building as a rough model. This was he did it in 2 weeks as a study of analyzing how in one model you can actually say one thing with different scales, no, from the territorial to the meso to the more architecture scale. So the scavengers and other creatures in Promised Lands is not trying to deny reality, is not trying to shy away from certain questions, but is trying to understand that perhaps there is something myth that is valid today. It's valid for many communities, but it also can help us to understand different ways and sensibilities to move forward. The cultures are dynamic. They are in constant shift, and it's important to understand which shifts are welcome, which shifts are not so good, and how can technology operate to mediate and improve the connection between infrastructure and livelihood. He is also asking questions about how can we ask our questions? No, how can we find different ways of asking questions for the most important problems in the world, some of the most important problems in the world? I'm not saying that this is the definitive answer. Is a way to find multiple possibilities. For the students, is 1 year in a hopefully a very rich and fruitful career in a, I guess, 40-year future careers that they will have in architecture. For us, is a continuation of a research that is started back in 2002 when I arrived in London with the dream and hope of kind of meeting my heroes and kind of being part of learning their work and their world, that speculation in architecture is not a denial of reality, but is a way to discuss these possibilities in infrastructures and environments today. If you want to know more about us, we have websites, etc., but we are mainly on Instagram, where we do videos weekly and also publish articles via Instagram, so we can always find us there. That was it. Thank you very much. Of course, yeah.
Okay, so. I think that we'll entertain a couple of questions.
If there are a couple of questions, we'll stand in contact.
There's a mass exodus first, yeah. And then the question. Do you want the mic? No, it's okay. Yeah, I think that a lot of the projects, they pass through a lot of a big critical frame, and I think they go through a lot of questionings around the role that the project has for the problem, the role that the project has for the different levels of problems, the actual problem that we see on the site, the problem there is that is connected to infrastructure, and also the civil questions that these projects raise, no? So I guess I haven't seen any sort of, there are some large structures, and I think size is not the issue here, but I think we use those structures to sort of to question the how those invisible structures can find a way to exist in a secular state and find ways to be traded and communicated and be part of their repertoire, that we can build cities or build architectures and spaces that can learn from them. So I think that when I keep repeating the culture is dynamic, I think that I will not go into the definition of identity, but I think that there is, I'm very interested as we pass in UK through the Brexit now, and we see my bubble, no, the bubble that I belong to, which is most of my bubble, the next day after Brexit, they call everyone who voted for Brexit an idiot. And I didn't vote for Brexit, but I felt that that was a little awkward to very quick call the other people idiots. And so I thought that there was, I got this thing in my head a few months later that the post book, no, the book was released before. It was released before Brexit. That the next book, and which I'm starting to write now, and the ideas, they are trying to work, what are ideas that bring us together? No, which seems to be a radical thing today, and it's actually, it used to be, someone tell me this 20 years or 30 years ago, I'll say, such a boring idea. But I think today, it now is leaning itself to be quite a radical idea, meaning that how can we look at people's sensibilities, histories, without creating ideological trenches about the pre-industrial past and where they come from. Because I think nothing is free from a thinking structure. Every time that we claim more health or more a better situation for certain communities or areas, there is ways of doing. And I think I'm very interested to find in a very civil way, that means taking that, maybe I'm going too far, maybe in that kind of democratic idea that is all right if people don't agree, and try to create a conversation that what are some ideas that bring us together? And I'm for sure this will create tension between some people that think that culture have elements of ownership, you know, that some people own cultures and they shouldn't be used. I think there is a ways of sensibilities, but I'm always very scared about the patrolling of culture, you know, that can occur sometimes with very good intentions, no? But I think we learned through the last 3 years, we all living on the same planet somehow, that I think ideology tends to bring answers too quick. No, and I think I developed in the last years a few ideas that I constantly police myself, that I always should keep some paradox in my thinking. So if everyone that thinks in a particular frame is gonna box tick all these things, no? Let's say if you agree with a certain issue, you agree with all the issues that go with those types of politics or, I think that is, if we all analyze ourselves a little bit, we all more complicated than that. So I think we all want justice, we all want the best for each other, but I think it's the way of how you get there. Yes, so I think the projects do discuss elements of cross-culture validity in terms of how we can learn from sensibilities of others. At the same time, he also discusses now the idea that we can add to our future projects fragments and pieces which are ancestral, which there's great lessons that they used to be conceived in the pre-industrial, no? So they had certain practices and they had certain figures and visuals. But now in a post-industrial modern, where we go to Ghana, Brazil, Indonesia, and they're very different, but they're also very similar. They have mobile phones, cars, social structures that they're partaking to those technologies. Long story short, I'm interested of how things that culture, understanding of cultures and under our environments that can bring us together, and maybe they get closer to the words that you mentioned at the beginning of your question. Let's see if we get there. Thank you. Okay. No, I never had a student with engineer background. Not that I know, not from the ones I show at least. The best honest answer for that is they start quite early, and the year starts in end of September and ends in end of May and end of June, let's say with the opening of our exhibition at the schools. So they have through work through several iterations. So these are not the working models. They start with putting things together like every other model, no, with a glue gun, with a plastic string. But we try to create a sense of a field of tolerance on the studio where the students, they know they to fail the model is okay, and to have a large aspirational is okay as well. So throughout the years, for good and bad, some of these models has become an aspiration for some students. So they go and talk to the previous students that we bring into the studio that made those models now, and then they talk to one another. And again, another great lesson as a teacher that students talk a language between themselves that, you know, is different, that they just get along and talk and exchange. So every year I bring, if my students are in town, I bring 3 to 4 in specific times of the year, and they show their portfolio, they talk, they spend 1 hour, 2 hours with us. I always invite my students, the previous alumni students also, to be part of juries and crits. So somehow that knowledge stays there. Some of them do workshops. So this is an incredible thing that without that network, no, I think it would be a lot harder to start those models from beginning. So at the beginning of the first year we did the studio, we had, I think, maybe luck that we had a student that was tremendously gifted to put things together, but she evolved a lot. No, she did 3 models, and the final model I didn't show, but it was a beautiful crafted laser cut piece. So I think it's about insistency, it's about having the network to create a sense of trust that you can get there without being the other person's model, but to make your version of based on your project. And I think that culture is really powerful. Perhaps the most important thing that I learned in teaching, in terms of dealing with teaching, is the horrible, boring term, is really important. Let's say a group dynamic. No, without that, it's impossible to teach. It's just with that is great because there is that thrilling idea that I have no idea how they're going to get to those models, but we have a couple of ideas. We have people that they can talk to. So I think enlarging the network, making sure the students talk to students, making sure that the knowledge that they develop zips back into the unit, creating a culture that is okay to get to finish the year with some documents and a final piece, which is more substantial, which takes time. So for example, that drawing with the inflatables, do you remember, that goes up and down? That drawing took honestly saying, a month. But she designed the project through that drawing. So she was, I wish I had, I tried to find a render, the first render she did. Was everything different, was some kind of bad meshes all over, some things. But then going through the same drawing, sketching on the same drawing, developing the sectional, the structural, the spatial. And then we took that drawing and took to create the project. So she had to cut another section to create a plan. And then she had to say, oh, how does it look from this side? Okay, let me design this side. So I think this kind of aspirational quality of producing a drawing that communicates an idea is really a process. It's really a process that they learn thanks to the students which are around, and the idea that they can achieve great work because there is example before, not just in the unit, but around. No? And I think that is the best way to learn this motivation, I'll say. You mean in the daily task of us architects and students making projects? Yeah, good question. I never thought about it that way. I think that there's an incredible field there that every architect knows well, that there's something happens when you are designing, you know, I mean, some people do a lot of diagrams and iterations on that sense. I don't work that way, but I think there is, of course, really valid for some of my friends. So they work through the more diagrammatic iteration. I think the way that we work is trying to visualize as kind of a few recipes. You know, so you have a few components, and you try to, there is a problem somehow that you want to connect to, and it becomes a game where sometimes you put pieces together, you play with scale, we play with material. And I think that I wouldn't call that part of the magical story that I'm telling today. I'll say that this is a beautiful phase that we architects like, the idea of creating, no? I think that there's some conversations which I really enjoy, which is the idea, for example, by Chesterton, a guy from the early 20th British or English 20th century writer, which talks about that it's okay to like something for its aesthetical qualities. Something that we kind of unlearn today in most of our environments is okay to like something because a myth. He gives the example actually of a myth that, for example, that there is a joy in a story of an Australian Aboriginal myth that this big frog swallow everything, the whole, I don't want to say planet, but in the land and the water, and then there's just a snake that gets hooked to its nose, and that snake start kind of going crazy and makes the frog sneeze. And when the frog sneezes, it puts everything out, and that's the world. In a new shape. And then he's saying that it would be a lie to say that the part of that myth, there is not a joy, that who created that myth also had the joy of telling that as an interesting and beautiful and funny story. And he was a bit talking about that it's not only the structures of, let's say, the frog represents a totemic structure or the fertility. I think this is also valid, but I think there's also the axis of transcendence, you know, the idea that you elevate something because it's beautiful, because it has, I think that is more, I like that idea of the invisible layer there. I mean, a bit different to what I spoke today. but the idea that we can also discuss or find ways against to discuss and validate the projects by their design content, not just by the speech content. So I think that is a very important thing that we need to try to, I'm talking about my reality in London, for example, that we need to learn to do in architecture schools, how to translate the powerful and unique sensibility that we all have, you know, and how we can somehow learn to share that and convey that into a larger body with the city. So yeah, I'll say that conversation is interesting, the idea that the invisible layer of creating something is beautiful. You can say that it's magical, but that wasn't the meaning that I was discussing magical today. Magical was saying more really on that sense that that it has it exists because it has a direct contrast with a reality that says that is magic. No, so it exists in this kind of dual dance that says that you're there because this magical that I'm describing exists because there is a structure that says that is magical. But sometimes it's just a practice. Sometimes it's a story that brings people together. Sometimes it's a story that makes people partake into their binding as a community. I think that's it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Turn off this one. Guys, I'll turn this off.